So Dr. Parun is going to say no to eye drops, and she's again specialized in cornea, cataract and refractive surgery, a very astute surgeon with a great presence in Mumbai. On to you, Dr. Parun.
Thank you, Dr. Chitra. I'll just share my... Yeah, so can you see my slides? So are my slides visible?
Yes. So it's visible.
Okay. Thank you, Chitra ma'am. Thank you, ARC, AIOS, for giving me this opportunity. So far we've heard from all the speakers that how wonderful is a DALK procedure, especially in patients with corneal ectasias. However, in some of the cases of post-eye drops, complicated cases, it may not be the ideal procedure, especially for a novice surgeon or an inexperienced surgeon. So corneal eye drops, as we know that it occurs only in 3% of the cases, it resolves usually over a period of 2 to 4 months, and it leaves behind a corneal scar, which usually hampers the visual acuity. These patients, however, can be improved with the contact lenses, but some of the patients still would require a corneal transplant procedure. So which procedure? DALK, as shown by Dr. Sujata Mohan, who is an expert cornea surgeon, or penetrating keratoplasty? So I would just try to prove some of the facts, clarify some of the facts while deciding to go with DALK or penetrating keratoplasty. So this is one of the articles. It was a retrospective study done by Paso and Reddy et al., where they have looked at 5 years outcome following penetrating keratoplasty in cases of resolved eye drops. And they found that the outcome, long-term outcome, as well as the visual acuity, despite having a higher rate of endothelial rejections, was excellent. So some of the factors that we need to look at when we are managing a post-corneal eye drops is corneal scarring. So if there is an extensive amount of corneal scarring which is involving the Descemet's membrane, and if it's centrally located, it is better to do a penetrating keratoplasty and not a DALK. So this is one of the patient. The left hand side is the acute eye drops picture, and the right hand side is the resolved eye drops. Look at the amount of scarring which is present in the deepest stromal layer as well as the endothelium. So this patient probably would do better in terms of better with penetrating keratoplasty if we are looking at a better visual outcome. In contrast to this patient, where you can see the paracentral corneal deep scar, but it's not involving too much of the Descemet's membrane, this patient probably would do better with DALK in a normal surgeon's hand. Second thing that we have to look at is the health of the corneal endothelium in these cases. So it's been seen that the post-eye drops cases, the corneal endothelial cell density remains good in majority of the patients, but about 20% of the patients still will have 15% or more drop of the cell count. Besides, the morphology usually gets affected in most of the cases of acute eye drops. The second thing is that when we compare a long-term visual outcome as far as the endothelial cell loss is considered with DALK and penetrating keratoplasty, it's been seen that an uneventful case of DALK without an intraoperative corneal perforation has a much better endothelial cell count at the end of 1 year when compared to penetrating keratoplasty. But if you have an eventful DALK with an intraoperative corneal perforation, the endothelial cell loss is equivalent in both DALK and penetrating keratoplasty at the end of 1 year. So as Dr. Sujata Mohan has already discussed, that we need to modify the technique of surgery in these patients. We need to do a manual dissection. In event of dissecting, it's important to leave the area of thinning the last, but one may sometimes leave behind a greater amount of residual stroma in order to avoid the macroperforations. So in these patients where you are performing a DALK, you always have the scare of perforation, and hence one has to always keep a good quality donor tissue. And it's important that one performs this procedure under general anesthesia, as we are likely to take a longer time. So cases where we may not be able to take general anesthesia, probably PK would be a better option. And when we look at the visual outcome, it's been seen that a DLK procedure performed with the residual stroma more than 20 micron, usually the visual outcome is subnormal and it is not equal to what we achieve with a big bubble DLK or a penetrating keratoplasty. So with this, my indications for penetrating keratoplasty usually post hydrops are cases of severe hydrops with large Descemet's membrane tear, which is more than 3 millimeter width, as you can see in this photograph, or when there is an acute perforation in cases of acute hydrops, or there is a persistent chronic edema, which indicates some amount of endothelial dysfunction, or when you have a dense scar in the visual axis, or you've encountered an intraoperative macro perforations and you will have to resort to a penetrating keratoplasty. Those cases which are high risk for general anesthesia, probably I would avoid a DALK procedure and I would head to a penetrating keratoplasty. And the last indication being the associated endothelial dysfunctions, which are present in patients with keratoconus, like in this patient where there is a PPMD coexisting with the keratoconus. So probably I would resort to penetrating keratoplasty in these patients. So to conclude, DLK definitely yields good visual outcome in all cases of keratoconus, but it definitely demands high surgical expertise, especially in advanced cases as well as cases with high drops. And PKP has a good visual recovery. It has a good long-term survival in all cases of keratoconus, despite having high risk of ejection. So I, with this, I conclude. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Parul, for all your strong counters. I just wanted to ask Dr. Jagdish Reddy, what tips would you give for suturing to our attendees if the host rim gets quite thin, which is likely, if you're doing dark in hydrops? Can you stop sharing?
Sorry, ma'am. Yeah.
So I think it's very important to look at you involve the entire cone. So if you do have a thinning in the periphery, that means you do have a part of ectasia still left over. So I think it's very important preoperatively to look at the extent of the cone and using a slit lamp examination and marking on slit lamp examination, the extent of cone and looking at the topography as well. And on table, trying to remove everything, you may not have difficulty while suturing. But if you have some amount of ectasia still in part of your trephination, you're going to end up with a thin cornea in that area that may cause difficulties. Usually with keratoconus, we don't face much problem in suturing, but you do encounter an issue with PMCD. Wherein you have inferior thinning and keratoglobus, that could be one of the situation where if you get mistaken by that it's a keratoconus and try to do a keratoplasty, wherein you would have a lot of difficulties during suturing.
Dr. Bhaskar Srinivasan, I wanted to ask you, if it is a situation where there are deep vessels which have happened in hydrops, or if there's an allergic eye disease, in those situations, would you still prefer to suggest PK for hydrops?
Yes, basically, when you're looking at an option between PK and DALK in a high-risk situation, I would probably want to err more in terms of a DALK rather than a PK to begin with. The issue is if it's a post-hydrops case, you might end up, you might not be able to bear the DM. So you might actually sometimes end up having sutures getting loose faster. You might end up having vascularization tricking into the interface and such. But if it's a very vascularized or an allergic eye disease, doing a, and most of these eyes would probably require a much larger graft, 8.5, 9, or 10. So if you're doing a large graft, hot bed, uncontrolled allergy, these are all factors where the risk of rejection of a PK is going to be higher. I would prefer to do a DALK. If the haze in the center doesn't give me a good visual recovery, I can always go ahead and do a central 7 millimeter or an 7.5 millimeter PK subsequently, which is at least limiting my allogenic tissue more to the center away from the vascularized periphery.
Thank you very much. Dr. Rajesh Fogla, anything to add before we go on to our next speaker?
I think both the speakers have valid points among the cases that they have discussed. But in my practice, if we see a hydrops, we always try to medically manage by either using compression suturing combined with gas bubble in the anterior chamber. Because in majority of cases, once the hydrops resolves, the patient's visual acuity also improves. So you can get away without doing a corneal transplantation procedure. And also, surgery also becomes easier when the corneal edema has resolved. You can do, even if you're doing a manual DALC, you can achieve a much better dissection plane and give much better outcomes. And often you may find that the diameter of the graft that you require will be smaller when the edema is resolved. Whereas in the presence of edema, you will have to go and choose a much larger diameter because of the edema that's occupying the central or paracentral cornea.
Thank you.